So as we've seen, object references are like pointers from an object variable name to the actual object data stored somewhere else in memory. That actual object data can have multiple references pointing to it, such as when we equate objects to each other using the assignment operator. Or that object data can have no object references pointing to it. In this case, the object data is stranded or orphaned in memory, so to speak, and is thus marked for garbage collection by the Java Virtual Machine, or JVM. If the JVM detects some object in memory that no one is pointing to, that memory will be freed up for other use. We can accomplish the same thing explicitly by setting some object name equal to null. Let's take a look at what we mean by all this. Here we see a visual depiction of two object references pointing to the same data in memory. Let's say that for starters, we declare two new Java objects of type CS12Date, HireDate, and PromotionDate. These aren't initialized objects yet, they're just object references at this point. Next, let's say that we initialize HireDate to the indicated values using month, day, and the year constructor form, as shown here. Now an actual object's worth of data has been set aside in memory and initialized to the desired values, as shown here. And the object reference for HireDate now points to it in memory. Then, by assigning HireDate to the other object reference PromotionDate, we are simply having that other object point to the same data in memory. If any of these values change, both of these objects will see the change. We have two objects pointing to the same underlying data in memory. Once again, this distinction between an object reference and the actual object data is important only so that you can understand what's going on under the hood in memory. From an application programming standpoint, all we care about is that we have these two CS12Date objects that we can refer to by these names, and that somehow they contain this date data. Let's take a look at some code examples of this. If you need to, please pause this video and view the code walkthrough video for objectreferences.java. Open up this file in JGrasp so you can follow along. You'll find this example in the example source code module on Canvas. Come back to this video when you are finished. As you can see in the cited example code, if an object reference exists but doesn't point to any object data in memory, it has a null value. The two situations in which you'll see this are if an object has been declared only but not yet instantiated, or if we want to explicitly delete an object by marking it for garbage collection by the JVM. If you try to do anything with a null object reference, for example, access or manipulate its non-existent data, Java execution will respond with a runtime null pointer exception error. We haven't really discussed yet what an exception is, but for now it just means that something bad or unexpected has taken place during program execution. Again, to see an example of null object references, you can take another look at the code walkthrough video for objectreferences.java. Come back to this video when you are finished. So to sum up, let's do a short recap of classes. First of all, always remember that classes are the general and objects are the specific. Classes are like the blueprints. Objects are specific instances that we stamp out with those blueprints. If you like the cookie cutter and cookie analogy, you can go with that. Classes encapsulate or bundle together two things: what a class is and what a class does. A class is described by its fields or instance variables, which are virtually always private. The actions of the class are described by its methods, most of which are usually public because we want the outside world to be able to interact with a class. A class is fully described by its API, or application programming interface. An API tells us as application programmers how to create a new instance of the class using its constructors, and then once we have one of those objects on hand, what we can do with it using its methods. An API tells us only what we need to know and spares us from all of the gory internal details of the code. By well-established good Java conventions, the names of classes begin with uppercase letters, while the names of objects created from those classes begin with lowercase letters, just like any other variables. Classes, in a sense, just constitute a whole series of new data types. Objects, then, are simply variables in our programs which are of those special extended data types. We create objects from their class blueprints or instantiate them using constructors. Constructors are simply special methods of a class which have the same name as the class itself. It's very common to have multiple versions of a constructor, and we call this overloading. And just like for any other regular variables in Java, objects must be declared and instantiated. This just means stating up front what their data type will be and then giving them some starting value, as we see here in the CS12 date examples using their constructors. Once we have some new object on hand, we then have full access to all of its methods using dot notation, along with a specific object name we're interested in. We must remember that the available methods of any API are always called in the context of some existing object, shown in these examples in blue, and never alone. Once again, the pattern is typically object.method, as seen in all of these examples. Now, there is one exception to this, but we'll discuss this later when we talk about static classes and methods. Finally, recall that when we declare an object, what we really wind up with is an object reference, which is simply a pointer of sorts to some other memory location. Once we instantiate an object, or give some value to it, at that point the object reference finally points to the memory that's been allocated just for that object's data. In fact, multiple objects, or more specifically, their object references, can point to the same body of memory and the same data. And if we ever want to get rid of some object, we can achieve this by setting its value to null, which orphans its associated data in memory and marks it for garbage collection by the JVM. Well, that concludes this discussion of using objects. Make sure you are reasonably clear on setting up and using the CS12 date object, because you'll be using it over and over in coming programs. Be sure that you've looked over the available source code examples and walkthrough videos for CS12 date before going too much further.